This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
We were planning to run a second interview with Diana Walsh-Pasulka about American Cosmic today. However, that is not to be. We were requested by some of the people who are mentioned in the book under aliases to have the interview vetted by them and those who work with them. And unfortunately, we were told that we had discussed some material that they could not allow to be broadcast. Since neither Diana nor I have a security clearance, we can't be told what it was. Therefore, it's not possible to edit the interview, and we have no choice but to not run the entire interview. Out of an excess of caution, I'm not going to interview Diana a second time. Instead, what I am going to do is I'm going to go through the book with you and describe my thoughts about the parts of the book that we did not discuss in the first interview. I have no security clearance, and I have no idea why anything that we talked about would be sensitive. So I am free to proceed in this manner. I want to say this at the beginning. As I said at the beginning of the interview last week, things are changing with regard to the levels of secrecy that surround the UFO-related and alien-related activities that are being carried out behind the scenes. I am aware of some of this, I think, and obviously Diana is too. We are both in a position, for different reasons, to be aware of these things. I have two reasons for being aware of them myself. The first one is that I do know quite a few people who work on the inside of this because they use me and my own knowledge and information in the context of some of their work. How they use it, I don't know, but I do answer their questions as best as I am able. Second, my implant works quite well now. In fact, it works sometimes a little too well because I'm a little bit like the Sorcerer's Apprentice with the implant. It took me a long time to get it going, but once I did, now if I just think about something I'm curious about, I'm liable to get an answer in a very short period of time. As Diana pointed out last week, the implant works using synchronicity. It works in all kinds of different ways. It is really the most amazing thing I've ever known to exist. And it's right in my ear. I'm touching it right now. I find this extremely cool. I've gotten used to the fact that I'm not alone in here, because I'm not alone in here. There's somebody who can and does involve themselves in my thoughts all the time. But I don't have any thoughts that I wouldn't want people to be involved in. I've never done anything bad in my life, so I've got nothing to hide, fortunately. Incidentally, if you're a person who does not like to hear me talk on this show, well, tune out now, because that is all you're going to hear in this journey. But I assure you, for those who want to keep listening, it's a good journey. You won't have ever heard anything like what I'm going to be discussing before, at any time, anywhere. Diana Pasulka is a scholar of religion. She is the chairman of the Department of Religion at the University of North Carolina. And it was in the context of her work in this field that she met the two people who are the primary sources of her information in American Cosmic, called in the book James and Tyler. Jacques Vallée also plays a certain role in her story, as does my co-author of Supernatural, Dr. Jeffrey Kripal, and I mention from time to time as well. She sees the UFO information in terms of belief communities, and we will discuss its very important relation to religious experience over the course of this discussion as well. In the early parts of the book, she discusses religion and belief communities and how it is that the UFO belief is related to the religions and folklores of the past. And she brings up Dr. Jacques Vallée's groundbreaking book, Passport to Magonia, which is about similar beliefs that have been held throughout the centuries. However, this is quite different, and Diana gets into the difference very quickly in her book, the difference being that there is a physical side to this. It's no longer a matter of mysterious beings from a higher realm coming down, as happened to Ezekiel, who assumed that what he was seeing were angels of some sort. And yet at the same time, as we'll see in a few minutes, she does talk about some of the people that she met as angelic beings. In fact, at one point, she talks about Tyler being a mix of human and extraterrestrial, and therefore identifies him as an angelic being. I found that interesting and amusing because I have been identified as a mix of extraterrestrial and human as well, and the people who decided that that might be what I was were not all that convinced that I had anything to do with angels, I can assure you. I told this story from time to time before. It happened in the late 90s when I was involved with the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence and ended up accidentally convincing some NSA people who were monitoring my activities that I was part alien and part human. And the next thing I knew, the entire street that I was living on, which was a short street in Brooklyn Heights at the time, was filled with mysterious cars that proved to be federal cars. And I had to call the general counsel for that committee and ask him to make them go away. And they did leave. But after that, I think that I was held under a great deal of suspicion. Not so Tyler. He seems to have been welcomed. And whether or not anyone is actually that, though, is really an open question in my mind. I do think it is important, as Diana points out in the book, to not simply abandon all of our past exploration of the phenomenon that we now call the UFO and visitor phenomenon, because there was a time when we thought that what we were experiencing was a relationship with angels and demons. And I know Tyler well, and he has certainly done many quite wonderful things in this world. He really has. You may be a beneficiary of some of the things he does. He has been immensely successful in his area of interest and expertise and has helped humanity greatly, no question about that. After Diana met Tyler, she was taken by him to a place in the New Mexico desert that is known as the Donation Site. As she points out in her book, materials from this site have been gathered for many years and have been used in developing processes and especially metallurgical processes that have helped the human species a lot. As Arena Scott mentioned last week, a lot of this work was done at the Battelle Memorial Institute, and I would assume is still being done there. I would hope so, because there's still, I'm sure, a great deal to learn and a great deal of value to be gained. In any case, the donation site isn't just a site where bits of metal and remains can be picked up and analyzed. It's that. But it is also much more. It is a message. It is spoken in the language of the visitors, which is a universal language that we can all understand if we just try. Now, here's what I mean. The donation site is close to the place where Sister Mary of Jesus of Agreda allegedly bilocated to the local Indian tribes in the early 17th century as what came by them to be known as the Lady in Blue, and converted them to Christianity, meaning that when the conquistadors came through a few years later, they were already Christian and therefore were not subject to the oppression of the Inquisition that came along with the conquistadors. Now, these two events being close to each other are a message together. Whether Mary of Agreda actually bilocated or not doesn't matter. It's not important. What is important is that taking the two things together can be a message, and a very important one, because what happened after the conquistadors came was that only a few people were prepared for their appearance. That was the Indians whom Mary had allegedly already converted, and the rest were devastated at every level. After the conquest of Mexico, within 10 years, 9 out of 10 people who had been alive in Mexico before the conquest were no more. They were all dead of diseases and oppression and attacks of various kinds by the conquistadors, and they were enslaved if they were still alive. So look at that warning. Remember what was said to Phil Corso, a new world if you can take it, but it's not going to be easy. We have to stand our ground. We have to stand on our own two feet with this thing. So this message has two levels. One level, it's a gift we're benefiting from enormously. On another level, it's a warning to be careful when you look at a miracle, what you might find behind it. Specifically, behind the Lady in Blue was the most terrible invasion that had ever to that time struck the Americas. And it didn't end. It continued on through the arrival of all of the Europeans and the absolute devastation of the world in the Americas that had existed then. Now there's a completely new world here. The Native Americans have been pushed onto reservations. Their old ways are being forgotten, even by their own kids in many cases. And this is what happened. So it's a warning that the appearance of a more advanced and more powerful culture, in this case technologically advanced, not necessarily spiritually more advanced than the Native Americans at all, is dangerous. So beware, the message is saying, beware of what is going on and what is happening here. And remember, the conquistadors by the Aztecs were thought to be gods. And in truth, they were anything but. So as this evolves and develops and comes more and more out into the public, as it will, because I've been told for years, as the planet's viability as an environment supporting life declines, the visitors will become more and more visible to us, and that is happening. Right now, as I speak, the weather all over this planet is deranged. It's boiling hot in Australia. It's freezing cold in North America. Nobody really understands why this is the case, except, of course, the few people who read Superstorm. And at the same time, a book like American Cosmic comes out that takes us to a new level in our own understanding of the close encounter experience and gives us a glimpse into what is actually going on behind the scenes, what's actually happening. This is a remarkable glance because we can see in the book all kinds of absolutely fascinating things, not only about what is happening, but about the people involved. We get to know Tyler and James and something about the work that they do. I'm going to read from the book Tyler's description of the protocol that he uses in his contact experience. You know mine. I mean, I've talked about it many times. We call it the sensing exercise. Many of you do it. I do it all the time. I do it twice a day, as you know, at 11 and at 3. Tyler's approach is quite different. He says in the book, "I basically believe that there is evidence for this, that our DNA is a receptor and transmitter. It works as a certain frequency, the same frequency, in fact, that we use to communicate with our satellites in deep space. Humans are a type of satellite, in fact. So in order to receive the signals and transmit the signals, we have to tune our physical bodies and DNA. Because of this, I make sure I sleep really well. I use the 8+1 rule. That is, I sleep for 8 hours, wake up, then make myself go back to bed for an hour. That 1 hour, the top off, really makes or breaks my day. I barely drink alcohol as it interferes with sleep, and I never drink coffee. Coffee really messes up the signal. Now, my protocol is really very different because, as you know, I don't sleep a lot. But I've never slept a lot since I was a baby. In my whole life, I was always the only person awake at home when I was 8 years old. I would go to bed at 1 o'clock in the morning and get up at 5 and make my breakfast. So that's me. And a different protocol, because in spite of the fact that I don't sleep much, I do get enough rest. I have an excellent memory. And like Tyler, I'm in very good health. And I also have, in my case, a rather direct relationship with the visitors when it comes to foods to eat and so on and so forth. There's no objection to coffee in my protocol, but there is a concern about alcohol, and I drink very little alcohol. I have a little wine in the evening and maybe a little shot of a liquor later on. And then I do my meditation from 11 until now about 11:30 or 12, and then from 3 until 3:30 or 4, and that's my life. And now, she goes on, "I listen to Tyler as I sip from my coffee cup, trying to fight the exhaustion that comes from cramming too many activities into a 3-day conference." I was actually at that conference also, and it was a really interesting experience. "Jeff and I took turns asking Tyler more questions about his protocol and his connection to the off-planet intelligence. 'How does this help with your connection, and what does that connection feel like?' I asked. 'I also,' he said, 'have to be up with the sun. So I wake up, and the previous night I have gone to bed a little dehydrated. Then I get my extra hour of sleep and go out into the sun. While I bask in the light of vitamin D, I drink a tall glass of water, which flushes my cells and rehydrates them. This is better than coffee. It is at that point that I can usually feel the connection. I know I've established the connection when the thoughts that show up in my mind don't seem like my own. They're unfamiliar. With practice, you can feel the difference." Now, this statement has some very important information in it. He gets up with the sun, and he goes out every morning to commune with the sun. You know who else does that? Linda Moulton Howe. Linda Moulton Howe is deeply committed to her relationship with this light, because it's conscious light, by the way. And if you wish to think of it as conscious light, it will welcome you, believe me. I, however, am a different kettle of fish. I do a different kind of work, and I address the visitors in an entirely different way. My relationship with them is in the dark. And this, incidentally, is also why a lot of people on the inside who understand these things are scared of me and a little wary of me, because I am going through the dark. I work with the dark side. Does that mean that I'm a demon? Absolutely not. It doesn't mean that I'm a demon. It does mean, though, that I have to look very carefully to my own soul, because the side I work with will capture you away if it can. It's dangerous business. I'm not saying that it's not dangerous for others, but frankly, the ones who work in the light, it's easier, I think, than those of us who work in the dark. Why would I work in the dark? I work in the dark for a simple reason. There's knowledge to be had in the dark. The dark, the mandala of life, is a yin-yang mandala. And we are all traveling through the dark side of it. That's what life is. And gaining knowledge as we blunder along through the dark side. Then we die, we shed our physical body, and are completely surrounded by light, and we see the truth of our lives. We journey through the truth of our lives, gaining energy, and then eventually recover another body and are born again and do the same thing over and over. And most of us have been doing this for a long time and have been gaining immense amounts of energy. Souls are much more complex now than they were 100 years ago or 1,000 years ago or 10,000 years ago. And they are growing all the time in complexity. Your soul has been doing this too. Everybody's has. And when this planet comes to its climax, which it will soon, all of these extraordinary souls are going to be journeying forth in an entirely new way. And that is why the visitors are here. That is why all of this is happening. That is why American Cosmic exists. It's why Communion exists. It's why we are talking right now. A lot of the work with the visitors depends on synchronicity. That's how my implant works. It's one of the ways my implant works. It's very powerful, too. An example is I was needing to understand a relationship for the book I'm writing between magic and alchemy of the Renaissance and medieval era and modern science. And I asked the implant for help because I was really at a standstill. I went up to a friend's house. I've mentioned him to you before. Lee McCloskey and Carla McCloskey live up in Malibu. They have a wonderful collection of books about alchemy and about things like Renaissance magic. And I didn't mention this to anyone. And I sat down. We were having a meeting about something entirely different. And I suddenly noticed on the arm of the couch beside me a book called Eros and Magic in the Renaissance by Ion P. Cogliano. And so I said to Lee, where did you get this? And he said, well, where did you get it out of the library? I said, no. He said, well, how did it get here? I said, I've no idea. And I realized it was exactly what I needed. It was the book I needed, which had come somehow out of his library in the back of the house and landed on the couch arm beside me. It's in my hand right now, and I'm using it in my working on my new book, which is about, what else, communication with the visitors. But now let's look at another story. This is a story that Tyler tells. He was working on a capacitor, which would be used in pacemakers and things. And it's very important because the longer you can make those things last, the better it is for patients. He sent an email to a friend about it and then got an email back from somebody else asking about this. And he couldn't understand why this other person had sent him an email because he hadn't even told them about the project. But the long story short is that the two of them got together and they came up with a marvelous invention, a new capacitor that has greatly extended the life of pacemakers. And how did that happen? It was a seeming accident. He had sent the email to the wrong person in the first place. Now, there is a practice that amounts to a kind of magic that is opening your mind and allowing this sort of thing to happen, to flow. There has to be a kind of surrender, inner surrender to coincidence. You have to let go of that part that is trying to make your future happen, and then it will happen. It will come to you. What you need will come to you. And what happened to Tyler is a perfect example. And the result of that is all these people all over the world wearing pacemakers, maybe someone you know, maybe even you, are wearing pacemakers that last longer because of an errant email that was no errant email. A higher level of us, of our intelligence, because at this level, you forget about aliens. There's only us. And I don't mean, oh, there's only us here on Earth. I mean that we are everybody. Nobody is an alien. There are some with different biology than we have who come from different levels of reality and different planets even. But we are all one in this respect, all on this extraordinary journey that is known as the universe. Remember that just as consciousness is not in you, but you are in consciousness, also consciousness is not in the universe. The universe is in consciousness. As she left this level of reality, Anne Strieber left behind a book open called Physics from Fisher Information to a page on which are written the underlined words, "The gravitational structure of the universe was created out of a single primordial quest for knowledge. Every single being in this universe is part of that quest. We are all in it together." So, I'm far beyond the idea that there are aliens versus humans, and I'd be fascinated, don't get me wrong, to go to another planet. It would be extremely cool, and there's plenty of them out there, I'm sure. But so far, that hasn't happened. It will happen, not necessarily in my lifetime, but it will happen. I have a feeling some of the little ones running around on planet Earth might end up being running around on some other planets as well, and not just deserts like Mars, but planets that are richly populated and on their own extraordinary journeys around their stars, just like ours is. There is another individual in the book that Diana talks about extensively called James. In the book, James and Tyler meet each other through Diana, and they go to the donation site together, where James promptly finds some material, and it proves to be very useful and important. Some of this material, in fact, I don't think the piece that James found on that day, but some other material from the site has been analyzed by Dr. Jacques Vallée and found to have isotopic ratios that are not of this world and not even of this universe. So it's quite extraordinary, this material. What had happened in James's life some years before, that on reading John Mack's book, Abduction, Human Encounters with Aliens, he had realized that Mack was talking about things that had been happening in his own life. And as a result of this, this man, who is, like Tyler, a genius and had a very extraordinary reputation in the sciences, began to look into this sort of phenomenon, and then he proceeds to meet Tyler through Diana, who was a kind of facilitator in this case, and a whole new level of experience and discovery starts to unfold. And that's what this is all about. In the chapter called James, the Master of the Multiverse, she discusses James is starting to work on some of the materials that have been around for a long time, even beyond the materials that Jacques worked on, and beginning to make extraordinary new discoveries about these materials. And you must read this in the book, because it's quite fascinating what is being achieved. This is happening. This is real. The Defense Department's admission in December of 2017 that it did have video that could not be explained, of objects that could not be explained, rather, was a seminal moment. When Louis Alessandro released that material to the New York Times, the world changed. But this is so often the case when the world changes. We don't notice it too much at first. But a lot of people who have dismissed the UFO phenomenon and the close encounter phenomenon suddenly sat up and said to themselves, well, wait a minute, then this is all true. And therefore, if they are here, it must have something to do with us. Because if it turns out it has only to do with turkeys and raccoons and gorillas, we're going to be very disappointed. But in fact, that's not the case. We are the reason that they are here. And they are pointing us in a new direction. And this direction is beginning to become visible in books like American Cosmic. And as we go along, we're going to find that our spiritual lives are just as important in this as our physical lives, or maybe more so. Diana is a religious person. She's a Catholic, a practicing Catholic. Tyler is a practicing Catholic. I am a very religious person, not necessarily practicing as a Catholic, but certainly have Catholicism deeply embedded in my life and in my background. And you don't have to be a Catholic to succeed in being part of this phenomenon and working with the visitors. What you do have to do, and this is really important, boy, is you have to live a life of love, compassion, and humility. If you don't, then basically you are kind of like fodder. I mean, you indulge your life in negative ways, you're going to suffer for it. And that's as simple as that. There's no two ways about it. It just is the case. So bearing that in mind, don't forget those words, to live that way and to engage. Your own engagement is important. There is somebody, going to be somebody there for every single one of us. We are not alone. In fact, what we are projections of something greater that is using us and our bodies to have experience in this physical world, to have the experience of spontaneity and the rich sensation that comes from physical activity. This is why the sensing exercise is so important, because it takes the attention and puts it on the physical body, doing two things. One is it opens you to participation on the part of others who would like to also experience the physical world but are not able to for one way or another without your help. And two, it makes your very sacred attention come to literally to life in a new way. The attention is the most sacred part of a human being, because the visitors aren't necessarily here for intelligence. That's not what they're looking for. There are intelligent species here who can't control their attention. The cetaceans are a perfect example. Their attention is fixed and it goes where it has to. Our attention is controllable. The reason is very simple. We have hands and a big brain. That means that we have developed the thing that is looked for in this universe, which is a free attention. And we can use the attention, the free attention, to enhance and dignify our own souls. Now we're going to move on to talking about Scott, who is discussed in the chapter called In the Field in American Cosmic. The epigraph that begins In the Field is from Jacques Vallée, and it's important. Believe no one. Believe nothing. He said that in a personal communication to Diana. Never underestimate Jacques' importance in this whole thing. He is really a very, very central figure on both sides of the secrecy fence, believe me. And that is not to be forgotten. His books are incredibly valuable. Don't fail to read them. Don't fail to do that. Don't overlook Jacques Vallée's work. It's the core. It's the basis of understanding. In fact, I would very much recommend that you read his book Dimensions before you read Communion, and you read Passport to Magonia also before you read Communion. Then you'll have if you haven't read Communion already, you would have a much richer experience if you did. And the book I'm writing now about communication is very definitely, you should read Jacques Vallée before that book comes out. It's going to be important. Okay, now we're going to talk about Scott. His name is Scott Brown. He is a UFO investigator who has a bad habit of debunking UFO claims that are false. And if you follow the Out There section on Unknown Country at all, you'll know that our Out There editor finds almost 100% of all UFO claims or UFO videos and so forth that are on the internet to be either intentional frauds or mistakes or misapprehensions. Almost nothing that's real. Almost nothing. So if you want to find out what is real, go to Out There and explore it, because it's a curated section, curated by professionals. And it is a good place to look for things that are real, because there's a lot real gathered there. In fact, practically everything real is gathered there, I sometimes think. I'm sure we've overlooked a lot of stuff, and we're wrong in some cases to dismiss some things. But nevertheless, Scott Brown is not liked because he is such a debunker, but he has a vocation. His vocation is turned out to have been created something, an international group, as Diana puts it, called In the Field, which is a group of people who are attempting to photograph the real thing. And this is not easy to do. He has certain rules and requirements to join, and she mentions three. One, you must shoot your own footage and stills of anomalous objects on a regular basis and be able to present them to the group via YouTube or other means. Two, you must be familiar with the basics of the study of this phenomenon. Three, you must keep an open mind with no preconceived notions about the nature of the phenomenon, angels, demons, aliens, Galactic Federation, etc. This is, as she puts it, the group is not intended for those who wish to fuel the perpetual machinery of hoaxes and disinformation that make their work so much more difficult. Scott says, we do three things. We observe and study, we document and capture, we share. I don't accept anything that is CGI, false info, or disinfo. We don't want anything that reeks of a bad sci-fi movie. We encourage common sense. Scott is an experiencer. He asks, as you will notice, the people doing this to wait until they actually have been given something to see. In other words, if you make the right kind of effort with this and you go out with a camera, you're going to find things show up. And it's not hard. It is hard for me, because I've never managed to get it to happen. Only once have I gotten it to happen like that, or no, twice. And but not on a usual basis. If I go out on the beach with a camera at night looking for the visitor to show up, usually they won't. And they play games with me like that, and that's fine. But that's not the true of everybody. A lot of people can get this to come when they want it to. And this is because we're students. We're here in a school. It is the school of higher knowledge, and a school where the human soul is about to journey to a higher level. And people who are already on that level are trying to help us. And one of the ways they do that is simply exposing the fact that they are here to those who want to see that and want to record that. That isn't my job. My job is different. I'm a communicator. I'm to take information and redistribute it. Like, for example, the insights about the donation site and the nun, the blue nun. That's the kind of thing I do. That's my contribution. That's not in Diana's book, but it's very important information anyway. Diana reports that Scott, when he was a little child, had an experience of wandering off into a field and being found sometime later by neighbors. Of course, she was absolutely terrified because he disappeared at 5:30 in the morning, coming back saying he had chatted with the cows, even though, as the mother puts it, they were horses. Scott's brother, who was 2 years younger, had recurring dreams about his older brother, about Scott, throughout his childhood. She writes, in these dreams, he would see Scott on a table hooked up to machines, surrounded by people with big heads who were examining him. Scott also had recurring dreams, in one of which he saw a giant praying mantis looking into his window at night. He actually kept a praying mantis as a pet for a time. Now, how many of you have had things like that happen? A lot. Probably maybe quite a few of you. Now, these memories faded in Scott's mind until 1987, when they were revived by a series of disturbing experiences, similar in some ways to what happened to me about the same time. He had episodes of sleep paralysis. He sensed the presence of a being close to the bed, and it was menacing. When he tried to wake up, he found he was completely paralyzed, etc., and so forth. Now, this developed into a more intense interest in the UFO phenomenon, even though it started with sleep paralysis. And why? Because of his brother's recurring dreams. His brother is a messenger. And were they looking at Scott to examine him and as scientists from another planet? No, that's not what those examinations are about. Those examinations are about waking us up to this other presence. He then found a book similar to what happened to me. In his case, the book was Out There, The Government's Secret Quest for Extraterrestrials by Howard Blum. I knew Howard very well. In fact, she mentions that there was a blurb on the cover written by Whitley Strieber, who said, absolutely essential reading, which it was and still is. It's a wonderful book if you want to get Howard's book. Howard was told that it was okay if he wrote one UFO book, but if he stayed with it, he would end up like me, an outsider, which is what I am. And that's okay. I don't mind being an outsider, because I may be an outsider in human society, but in my relationship with the visitors, I am the ultimate insider in this world, in this time, and I am incredibly grateful for the position I have ended up in. Back way long ago, the old lady called, the visitor called me the luckiest of the lucky, and I have to agree with her. This is really something, this life experience that I'm having, and I want everyone to get their own version of it. And believe me, our life with the visitors will be as different as human faces. No two people will have the same experience of life with them. They don't want that, and we don't want that. Because you know what? If you think your faces are all different, look at souls. Souls are so different that you see two souls side by side, and you can't even tell that they're the same thing sometimes. They are radically different, because this universe is a quest for all knowledge. That means every single thing, everything. It will keep going on until we find all knowledge. Then it will recompress into a tiny instance of ecstasy. This is where we're going. Okay, now, you can find Scott Brown and In the Field on the internet by Googling In the Field Scott Brown and Browne, and you will find him, and he has a private Facebook group for people who are actively engaged in taking images, real images, of UFOs. And they are out there, and you could easily become one of them. If you read American Cosmic, the part about Scott's work, you'll find out how that can happen. And it can, as long as you're not me, that is. So, in any case, because this is not my work, this is not the direction I'm needed to go in. I'm about communication, not verification. And boy, I mean, they're so strict about that. I never get any verification. I never, in all the years I've been doing this, I've never gotten a single darned video of any consequence. I have the white moth videos, which are absolutely remarkable, but I've tried and tried and tried to get video of the visitors or of UFOs or anything like that. And I have not been able to do so, not personally. So that's not my job. My job is to understand and to explain methods of communication, which is a wonderful job, and I'm very, very glad to do it. In any case, in this chapter on Scott's work, she says UFOs are photogenic. She recalls Carl Jung's work that remarked that flying saucers are not photogenic, but he was wrong. It turns out they like to be photographed, and they're out there to be taken pictures of. My wife, Anne, used to always say, it's a theater. It's theatrical. It's a theater in the sky. And that is true. They are asking us to look up, look at the sky, and see the world in a whole new way. I think it's wonderful, and I think it's a lot of fun. Although a lot of the insiders are scared of me, as I said before, because I work with the dark side, I'm perfectly content to do that because I have a strong soul. I'm not a bad man. I don't have any guilt in my life. I haven't done anything wrong. And if anyone tries to make me think otherwise, as they sometimes do, I mean, some of the visitors would like very much for me to believe that I've done something wrong, I give them the bum's rush because I haven't. I do live as best I can by love, compassion, and humility. This is what I do. So, yeah, I'm willing to work with the ones that people call demons because they're basically not going to demonize me, and I find them very interesting and very, very informative. The dark is where we find new things that we did not know before. The light is where we can apply knowledge. And I'm so glad that people like James and Tyler are out there doing that. And Linda Moulton Howe as well, who is very much a being devoted to the light. Toward the end of the book, Diana spends a good deal of time talking about how it is that we are generating what this presence or phenomenon looks like to us. In other words, we make it into what it appears to be because we filter it through our own ideas, expectations, and senses. In other words, if it is something is primarily visible in the infrared and only secondarily visible in regular light, we're not going to see it as it really is, are we? And we're going to describe it in ways that are not correct. Like, for example, here's another example. If a person is a two-dimensional person and is completely flat and they can see just across a surface and a ball goes through that surface, a round ball, what they will see is a dot that both gets bigger and comes toward them, then goes back in turn and turns into a dot and disappears. At no time in that experience will they have any perception that the dot is really a ball. And this is critically important in understanding the whole phenomenon, because we have a phenomenon here that is unfolding on a spiritual level, on a perceptual level, and on a physical level. People like Tyler and James are taking the physical residue of this and making it into actual stuff that we can use that can help us in this world. Meanwhile, people like me are looking at that dot and those lines and trying to interpret those in a way that makes this make sense to us. And then you have to ask the question, can it ever make sense to us if we can't see it fully and clearly? And the answer is yes. And it comes right back down to this book I mentioned a little earlier, Eros and Magic in the Renaissance, which explains the way that Renaissance magic animated and influenced the discovery of modern science. And we can go back into that, as I will, in the communication book that I'm writing, and rebuild our understanding of reality in a completely new way. And when we do that, we will also build a viable relationship with this presence that I call the visitors, that you might call aliens, and that people might call the grays or the blondes or the reptilians or any of those things, any of those things. But are they really those things? This we don't know. And before we did our interview, Diana sent me a paper. It's actually a chapter in a book that's being prepared. It's called The Spectrum of Human Techno-Hybridity, The Total Recall Effect by Diana Walsh-Pasulka. And it starts out with the sentence, humans are cyborgs. Humans are biosystems integrated with technologies, from media technologies to biotechnologies. And this integration is what we build our perception of the world around us on. Diana goes on to say that cyborgs are not just the colorful human machines of popular culture, but rather humans are surprisingly cyborg-like in everyday ordinary ways, as well as in ways that are non-ordinary. There are degrees of human technological hybridity. And then she goes on to talk about the post-human and the transhuman and how other things are happening. False memories, for example, can be implanted in people and not by aliens. I mean, I suppose they could do it, and they probably are trying to do it to some extent. But the entertainment sector itself is used to do this. And it's not necessarily done by somebody who's trying to do it. It is done because deep in our minds, we can't tell the difference between a fictional memory and a factual memory. They get all mixed up together. And if you look hard enough on the internet, you'll find people who are attacking me because of the malleability of my memories. From the day I published Communion until recently, just a few weeks ago, in fact, I never reread one of my books because I understand that memory is malleable and flexible. And I wanted the differences to be apparent. Now, of course, I'm being attacked and said, well, his memories are all false because of the fact that they changed. They changed because of the stress that I was under. That's why they changed. You'll find, if you look it up, that stress causes memory to distort. And so does our world that we have made around us. Every time you walk into a science fiction movie, your vision of what this is and what the visitors really are changes. And this perhaps is the single most important message of American Cosmic, that while it's true that there are actual physical objects that are being extracted from a donation site and from other places and being used in our sciences to bleed out new processes and materials into the human world, while we can hold in our hands objects that have isotopic ratios so strange that they really frankly shouldn't even exist, that came from such sites, while that is all true and while there is biology associated with the sites as well, while that is all true, it is also true that the entire experience lives behind a screen of expectations, illusions, and true experiences. And you are the part of this culture that can find that truth, because most of you have had visitor experiences of one kind or another. Maybe just a small experience that glanced up and saw a UFO and have wondered about it ever since. Maybe you've had strange dreams. Maybe you're a close encounter witness like me who has a lot of experiences. But in any case, what we need to understand and what comes from American Cosmic so powerfully and from Diana's whole body of work is that there is a quantum indeterminacy to the experience. It is not fixed. It's something that we can create. And this is the main reason that the visitors stand back and don't sit down and talk to us. because they are waiting for us to create our side of the relationship and to find what aspects of them we can relate to. Because the phrase, a new world, if you can take it, the all-important phrase that was said to Phil Corso so many years ago, cannot happen unless we know how to take it. So get American Cosmic. Don't fail to do this. Get this book and read it. Read it carefully. And I urge you to read it in the physical form because, as Ann Strieber pointed out years ago, and as I followed up, and it's neurologically correct, the brain processes moving images differently from the way it processes still images. A physical book, the writing in a physical book will go deeper into your mind than it will if you're looking at it digitally, because even though the digital image looks still, it's actually in very fast motion, and your brain knows that. So get the book, get it physically if you will, read it carefully, and if you have questions for Diana or for me, well, send them to whitley@strieber.com, and I'll get them right to her. And she will answer you. She will definitely answer your questions. I'm quite certain of that. So here we are coming to the end of our hour together. I'm absolutely exhausted, as you may imagine. I hope you're not too angry at me for having done this myself, but I had no choice. Diana and I went too far down a path of some sort that we can't know about and said things that we shouldn't have talked about. So here I am, and here you are. I probably said them all again today, but since I don't know what they were, I can't know that, and neither can you. So we're both on the right side of the law with this. American Cosmic by Diana Walsh Pasulka, UFOs, Religion, and Technology. Don't miss it, and get it through us. Go to the Dreamland Show page and click there and on the Amazon link and get it through us, because that helps us a little bit. We're close to getting the new website up at last. Speaking of angels, some angels have come along and given me a little money to help do that. And so it's going along now faster. And once it's up, you'll be able to resubscribe again, and the journey will go on. What a wonderful journey. The old lady visitor called me the luckiest of the lucky, all right. And now, at last, after all the hell I've been through, I'm beginning to realize she told the truth. I love you very much. And you can't know how deeply true that is, how well I actually know you, everyone. God bless you.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening. 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 Thank you for listening.